Yes guys, let's start with the amalgamation problems. Question number 1. AX and BX amalgamated on and from 1st Jan 2012. And a new company, ABX, was formed to take over the business of the existing companies. So, two companies are amalgamating to form ABX Limited. So, double absorption here. There's some share capital which is given. Come down to your reserves and identify if there is any statutory reserve existing there. Yes. Check there. A general reserve and a P&L, and below that I have an investment allowance reserve and an export profit reserve. Both the reserves are your statutory reserves. I have to compulsorily take over those statutory reserves. ABX issued requisite number of shares to discharge the claims of the equity shareholders of transferor companies. Transferor company is nothing but the selling company, AX and BX Limited. Prepare a note showing purchase consideration and discharge thereof and draft the balance sheet of ABX Limited. Guys, whenever we are trying to solve problems, my step number one should always be computation of purchase consideration. My step number one is always purchase consideration. My step number two is to identify the nature of amalgamation. And its method of accounting. That means if my nature of amalgamation is merger, then my method of accounting is pooling of interest. If it is purchase, then I have to adopt a purchase method. My step number three, once you identify the nature of amalgamation, then we need to think about whether I am going for, if it is a merger case, that means if I am doing pooling of interest method, then I have to check for reserves of selling company taken over. If you remember, reserves are selling company taken over, we need to identify surplus, adjust the surplus against the reserve, balance reserve of selling company is taken over. So that will come out as a working note if you are following merger. If you have identified it as merger, then my third working note should be reserve of selling company taken over. If I have identified nature of amalgamation as purchase, then I won't get reserves of selling company taken over. Then my working note should be goodwill or capital reserve computation. How do we identify goodwill or capital reserve? We need to observe or compare purchase consideration with net assets taken over. This will give us goodwill or capital reserve. And my last working note should be the amalgamated balance sheet. Balance sheet post merger. These are steps that we follow. That means there is no accounting entries that we pass. Whenever we are talking about amalgamation here, we will not be passing any accounting entries. We'll straightforward go for the balance sheet. Unless and until the question clearly specifies or requires you to ask journal entries, we are not getting into the journal entries at all. So whatever we have seen yesterday for the journal entries, it was only for your understanding. Otherwise, when we're coming to the topic of corporate restructuring, we are not normally asked regarding the journal entries. We can directly go for the balance sheet after these working notes. Guys, you don't have to prepare both. My third working note will completely depend on what is your second working note coming out with. If it is a merger, then I will follow pooling of interest method and I will do reserves of selling company taken over. If it was a purchase, then I will follow goodwill or capital reserve and then the balance sheet. Balance sheet is common in both the cases. Now, let's go with the same framework throughout the questions. I'll start with the first one. The first one, if you read the question, ABX will issue requisite number of shares to discharge the claims of equity shareholders of the transferor company. First of all, When we have identifying purchase consideration, that is a first working note, we have two ways of calculating PC. Either you can do it by net assets method or you can do it by net payments method. When do I apply net payments? I have three conditions to apply a net payments method. Either you know the sum at which you are taking over. Am I given a particular amount at which they have taken over? No. Do I have the exchange ratio? Check the question. There is no exchange ratio. Do I have number of shares to be issued by the purchasing company? No. None of these three conditions are existing there. Then I cannot adopt a net payments method. Then I have to compulsorily go for net assets method. How do you check your net assets? Check your assets minus outside liabilities. That will be the total PC. So let's start. My first working note, as always, should be a purchase consideration. The method to be adopted here is net assets. All rupees are given in thousands. Let's start. Start with your assets. First asset. Let's maintain two columns on the amounts. Both are transferor companies, AX and BX. The first asset is sundry fixed assets. Sundry fixed assets are 8500 and 7500. I need to take my assets at realizable values. When no realizable values are given, I'll take the book values as at realizable values. Investments 1050 and 550. Next, stock. Stock is 1250 and 2750. Debtors 1800 and 4000. Cash in bank 450 and 400. That is the total assets. 13050 and 15200. It's the balance sheet totals. Pick up your outside liabilities then. Check the liability side. Go from bottom to top. There are two outside liabilities. The first one being creditors. 1000 and 1500. My debentures, 12% debentures are simply debentures. 3000 and 4000. My total liabilities are 4000, outside liabilities are 4000 and 5500. And this will give me my net assets or purchase consideration. $13,050 minus $4,000 is $9,050. $15,200 minus $550 is $9,700. I got the PC. There's no issue price given per share. So let's say we are taking it at 10 rupees, the same issue price or the same face value of AX and BX Limited. So no premiums here. If I take that the issue price per share in ABX is 10, then I'll identify that the number of shares are 905 and 970. With that, we come to the end of PC computations. Go for step 2. Step 2 is identifying the nature of amalgamation and method of accounting. Go on. Get me the nature of amalgamation. Read the question carefully. And we can identify the nature of amalgamation. Check first, whenever you have a nature of amalgamation, we need to check if it can be called as a merger. For it to be called as a merger, first thing, all assets and liabilities are taken over. I'm taking over all assets and liabilities once a condition satisfied. Second one, they should be taken over at book values. There's no change to the book values. I've done second one satisfied. Purchase consideration should be only in the form of shares. Absolutely, there's no other form of purchase consideration given. So I can call this as merger. I know guys, there are 5 conditions, but like I told you, only check for 3 conditions. The other 2 conditions, whether 90% of the shareholders are becoming the shareholders of the purchasing company, I don't know. Whether the same line of the business is continued by the purchasing company, that also I don't know. So the other 2 factors automatically will follow, but only check for this. If it is a merger, then my method of accounting should be called as pooling of interest. If my method of accounting is pooling of interest, then my third working note should be reserves of selling company taken over. So start with that. AX and BX, maintain 2 columns. Guys, do not write the format, okay, first. Because we don't know whether the selling company reserves are sufficient or the purchasing company reserves are sufficient. So let's go step by step. One more thing, there's no purchasing company reserve. Because the purchasing company is a new company being formed. In a new company being formed, you don't have a reserve as such. Right? Unless and until these shares are issued at premium. If these shares are issued at premium, then I'll have securities premium, which is applicable for purchasing company, even though it is a new company. But here I don't have. So let's start the working note. The first thing that we need to do is identify surplus. How do we identify surplus? Compare purchase consideration compare this with share capital of selling company. Come on, PC 9050 and 9700. Compare it with the share capitals of selling companies. AX share capital is 6000, BX share capital is 7000. From this, we can say that the surplus is 3050 and 2700. Surplus adjusted against reserves of selling company. First, let's take selling company reserves and adjust the surplus. Check the selling company reserves. Go for the balance sheet again. How many reserves do I see for against which surplus can be adjusted? Surplus cannot be adjusted against statutory reserve. So other than statutory reserve, what reserves do I have? I have a general reserve and a P&L. So let's write down that first. Come on. Let's start. For AX, I need to absorb 3050. General reserve is 1500. P&L is 1000. Total I have only 2500. 1500 and 1000. insufficient. So we need to write it as unabsorbed surplus or unadjusted surplus. What do I do with the unadjusted surplus? Transfer to goodwill. Check. Unadjusted surplus is out of 3050, if I have absorbed 2500, unadjusted surplus is only 550. BX. 2700, how much do I have? General reserve of 2000 and P&L of 500. General reserve of 2000 and P&L of 500. 2500 adjusted, unadjusted surplus again 200. Finally, reserves of selling company taken over. What are the reserves taken over? I have four reserves. I have utilized general reserve and P&L fully. So the other two reserves can be taken over. The other two reserves are nothing but your statutory reserves. Investment allowance reserve and export profit reserve. These two reserves will be taken over completely. Check, it is 550, 100 and 100. Let's try to derive something. So whenever such a question comes, I don't have to do your third working note at all. I can directly give the answer. How do I get it? Observe one simple logic here. Did you get it? My unadjusted surplus transferred to goodwill will be exactly equal to the reserves which are taken over, that is a statutory reserve. That is always there, provided your purchase consideration is calculated as per net assets method and your nature of amalgamation is merger. If these two conditions are satisfied, my purchase consideration is calculated as per net assets method and my nature of amalgamation is merger, in such situation I can say that the unadjusted surplus transfer to goodwill will be exactly equal to the statutory reserves of the selling company. Got it? So next time whenever we see such a problem where we start doing net assets method and we have identified nature of amalgamation as merger, then we will directly give you the answer. So we don't have to go for this working note. Directly looking at the question, I'll say statutory reserve are 500 plus 50. 550, 550 is the goodwill. And for BX Limited, 100 plus 100, 200, 200 is the goodwill. Straightforward. I can completely skip this working note of the term. Yes? So you can generalize it. Let's write the statement. When PC is calculated as per net assets method, and your nature of amalgamation is merger, then I can say that goodwill, that is nothing but unadjusted surplus, is equal to statutory reserves of selling company taken over. This is a generalized statement. We'll maintain a similar thing where we do PC as per net assets method, nature of amalgamation taken as purchase, then also I'll have something to be generalized. We'll see that. We'll see that as we progress. But this is one thing which we can reduce from this. So let's go for the balance sheet now. Balance sheet of this new company, ABX Limited. Again, we need to follow Schedule 3 of Companies Act 2013. Balance sheet of ABX Limited. As on 1st Jan 2012. Schedule 3 format. First start with equity and liabilities. Shareholder funds. Share capital. There's no preference. There's only equity share capital in ABX. How many shares did I issue? 905 and 970. Total 1875 shares. Each share of 10 rupees. So 18750, all rupees in thousands again. Reserves and surplus. What are the reserves of selling company taking over? I have two reserves taken over. One is an investment allowance reserve and other one is an export profit reserve. Investment allowance reserve taken over 500 plus 100. Export profit reserve taken over 50 plus 100. So this is 600 and this is 150. Your goodwill should be exactly equal to these two values. Go to your non-current liabilities. One non-current liability is your 12% debentures. $3,000 plus $4,000, my total non-current liability is $7,000. Current liabilities, we have creditors, total it 1000 plus 1500, 2500. Next, assets. Under assets, first one, non-current assets. Under non-current assets, first one, tangible fixed assets. Sundry fixed assets, total is 8,500 plus 7,500, 16,000. Intangible assets, goodwill, total goodwill 750 should be exactly equal to your statutory reserve taken over. There's no other non-current assets existing in the question. Yeah, there is investments. Other non-current assets, investments, total 1050 plus 550 is 1600. Then up with your current assets. Three current assets. First one, stock. 1250 plus 2750, stock taken over. Total is 4000. Debtors. Check 1800 plus 4000, 5800. Finally, cash. 450 plus 400 is 850. Doing this total is 28,000 or 29,000. Yes guys, turn to the second one. Question number two. Long and short, amalgamated on and from 1st of April 2012. Moderate Limited was formed to take over the business of the existing companies and the summarized balance sheet of long and short as on 31st March is given below. A nice neat drafted balance sheet coming up there. Check, is there any statutory reserve on the liability side? Yes, there is. There is an investment allowance reserve which is given there as 50 and 30. Yes, come down below. 13% debenture holders of long and short are discharged by Moderate Limited by issuing such number of 15% debentures so as to maintain the same amount of interest. The interest what they were earning at 13% should be equal to the interest that they will be earning at the rate of 15%. So what do you have to calculate? First check what is the interest that they are getting now. So I will do 13% debentures and 13% into 50, 13% into 28. That is the debenture interest that they are receiving today. And after amalgamation they have to receive it from Moderate Limited in the form of 15% debenture. How will they get? Divided by 15%. That is your discharge to debenture holder. Next, preference shares of both the companies are issued equivalent number of shares. Equivalent number means same numbers. So in the same number, at 15% preference shares, having an issue price of 125 rupees per share each. Moderate Limited will issue 4 equity shares for each equity share of long and 3 equity shares for each equity share of short. The shares are to be issued at 35 rupees having a face value of only 10 rupees each. Investment allowance reserve is to be maintained for 2 or more years. Prepare the balance sheet of Moderate Limited as on 1st April 2012 after amalgamation. The first thing we need to check is purchase consideration. In a purchase consideration again we have two methods. So let's check whether we can apply a net payments method or not. If I am not able to apply net payments then I will apply net assets. Check. To both preference as well as equity shareholders is coming up with something. Preference shareholders of both the companies are issued equivalent number. That means 1:1 ratio. Come down. Equity shares will issue 4 equity shares for every share in long 3 equity shares for every share. In short, your exchange ratio is 4:1 and 3:1. Exchange ratios are given to you, then we have to follow net payments method. So let's start. Put down heading purchase consideration. Put a hyphen and write down net payments method. Guys, your purchase consideration is paid to the shareholders. Shareholder in the sense, I can call both equity as preference shareholders as shareholders. So a sum total of consideration paid to equity as well as preference shareholder can be called as purchase consideration. I cannot include debenture because he is not the owner. He is only a liability. Purchase consideration, net payment method. Again, I have two companies, so let's name the two companies long and short. All rupees are given in lakhs. I'll start with the point number two. Point number one is not PC because point number one is talking about debenture holders. Debenture holders are not the owners. So what I'm paying to the owners, I'll start with point number B. We'll call it as PC to preference shareholders. Purchase consideration to preference shareholders. Let's check. Number of preference shares, or 15% preference shares to be very precise. Number of preference shares, 15% preference shares to be issued by moderate limited. Moderate limited being the purchasing company, they are issuing equivalent number of preference shares. So it is the same number what is already existing as far as the selling company balance sheets are concerned. 3.2, each share is 100 rupees and 1.75. However, each share is issued, that means my issue price per share. Each share is issued at a price of 125. Face value is only 100. I'm issuing them at 125. I'll have a securities premium. So my PC to preference shareholders multiply A and B. The first one case it is 400. In the second case it is 218.75. This is PC to preference shareholders. Come to the second part, PC to equity shareholders. Number of shares in selling company. Start with that. How many shares are there in your selling companies, long and short? Each equity share is 100 rupees. So 8.5 and 7.25. Exchange ratio. Read point number 3, you will get the exchange ratio. Moderate limited will issue 4 equity shares for each share of long. 4 shares for 1 share. Next, it will issue 3 equity shares for each share of short. 3 shares for every 1 share. Striking this, we get number of equity shares to be issued by moderate limited. First case 34, second case 21.75. Don't call this 0.75 as fraction because rupees are in lakhs. So 0.75 is not fractions. Issue price per share. Each share in moderate limited is issued at a price of 35. This will give me PC to equity shareholders. First case it is 1190. 761.25. To make it easy, we'll start one more working note, which is discharge of PC. Discharge of PC is a working note to just write the summary of what we have done so far. Now, basically, whenever I'm talking about this PC to preference shareholders, I have a portion of 15% preference share capital and I also have securities premium. Same case even with equity shares. I have my issue price is 35, 10 rupees face value, 25 rupees premium. So let's try to separate it. PC to preference shareholders, I'll have to split it between 15% preference share capital and securities premium. In the same way, my PC to equity shareholders also should be split between equity share capital and securities premium, so that we can write the total PC below. My total PC is PC to equity shareholders plus PC to preference shareholders. It should total up to 1590 and this one should total up to 980. Check. 15% preference share capital, 3.2 lakh shares, each share of 100 rupees, 320. Issued at 25 rupees premium, 80. 1.75 shares, share capital 175. Securities premium, whatever the balance, 25 plus 18 is 43.75. Come to this. 34 shares, each share of 10 rupees. Equity share capital is 340, but issued at a premium of 25 rupees each. If it is issued at a premium of 25 rupees each, then this should be 850. And this one, each share of 10 rupees, so 217.5. Securities premium is multiplied by 25. 543.75. It's just a summary of the PC that we have just calculated. That will make our balance sheet much easier to pick up. My second working note should be identifying the nature of amalgamation. It might look like merger, but it is not. A simple indicator for you that it is not a merger is with your debentures. Because when I take over the debentures of 13% by issuing 15% debentures, maintaining the same amount of debenture interest, then the discharge to debenture holders will automatically decrease. because I am maintaining the same amount of debenture interest. So 13% debenture interest, whatever is earned, if I have to give it with a 15% debenture, automatically the value of the debenture will decrease. So you cannot take it as merger. It is compulsorily a purchase. My method of accounting is purchase method. We have called it as a purchase based on discharged debenture holders, which we have never calculated. So calculate that first. Discharge to debenture holders. Some peculiar thing will appear, guys, when you're doing discharge to debenture holders. Be slightly careful in this. Again, two companies, again, two columns, long and short. Read the point. Number one. 13% debentures of long and short are discharged by moderate limited by issuing such number of 15% debentures so as to maintain the same amount of debenture interest. So first identify debenture interest in selling companies. Debenture interest in selling company. Come on. How do you calculate 13% on 50 is 6.5. 13% on 28 is 3.34. Same amount of debenture interest should be maintained, but the yield per debenture has now increased. Yield per debenture in moderate limited is 15%. Calculate. Then my discharged to debenture holders might arrive in points, no problem. This should be 43.33 24.27. Guys, actually if you observe, this is 43.33333 and so on. There's a bar figure there, continuing decimal here. Here also it is a continuing decimal because it is 24.26666 and so on. I can't issue exactly such debentures. So what we'll assume is, this part we'll assume it as fraction debentures. We'll assume this 0.33 or 0.27 as fraction debentures. Another way of assumption is, you take 43.33 as a round figure, then that remaining 0.33s are all your fractions. And this one you can take it as 24.26 as your debentures and that 0.66 as fractions. Anything is fine with me. I will take for an easier purpose 0.33 and 0.27 as fractions. So in your discharge, I will say my 15% debentures in moderate limited is only 43 and 24. Balance fraction debentures in cash is 0.33 and 0.27. Guys, they are running decimals. They are running decimals. You beat in lakhs, figures, beat in crores. They are always coming to decimal places. That is not the same case in the case of equity shares and preference shares because they were perfect decimals. Sufficient enough. When I have a purchase method, then what do I have to do? My next working note should be goodwill or capital reserve. So let's go for that. Identify goodwill or capital reserve. to identify goodwill or capital reserve, compare two things. Net assets with the PC. So net assets, let's maintain again two columns, long and short. And start off. How do we calculate net assets? I'll start with first assets. One. First one. Land and building. There's no change to the value of assets. 460 and 275. Plant and machinery. 325 and 210. Investments. 75 and 50. Stock. 325 and 269. Debtors. 305 and 270. Bills receivable. 25 and nil. Cash and bank balance. 385 and 251. Total is 1913.25. That is your balance sheet totals. Outside liabilities. Bills payable. 20 and nil. $145 and $75. Public deposits, 25 and nil. Debentures, and stop. All assets considered at realizable values, all liabilities considered at settlement values. 50 and 28 is not the settlement values. We have already calculated the settlement values as 43.33 and 24.27. So never take the book values. Always take the settlement values for liabilities. There is a change here. So it is 43.33 and 24.27. That's it. That will bring us to the end of the outside liabilities. You can total the outside liabilities and identify what is your value of net assets taken over. When your net assets are compared with the amount of PC, we identify the values of goodwill or capital reserve. The discharge to debenture holders is nothing but your settlement value of debentures. Yes, my total liabilities here is 99.27 and this will make it 1225.73. This total liabilities are 190, 233.33 and 1666.67. My total PCs, we already have the figures, 1590 and 980. Compare with the PC. I am paying 1590 to take over a net asset of 1666.67. I paid less. So this will result in capital reserve. capital reserve is 76.67 and 245.73. Sum total of my capital reserves will come up to 322.4. Sufficient enough information to go for balance sheet. Balance sheet of moderate limited. As on whatever date is given there. And complete the balance sheet. Be careful when you are doing the balance sheet. Yes guys, the balance sheet will be done on 1/4/2012, all rupees and lakhs. Starting with the equity and liabilities. First one is shareholder funds. share capital. Share capital includes both equity as well as preference. Come on. Equity share capital is 340 plus 217. It is 557.5. Preference 320 plus 175 is 495. Reserve and surplus, first pickup securities premium. This total is 123.75. And one more securities premium right here. This is 1393.75. That sum total will come up to 1517.5. That is the total securities premium. Total, both the securities premium of both preference as well as equity is total. Then I have a capital reserve. We just identified the capital reserve as 322.4. What about my reserves? Any other reserve? Guys, it is a purchase method. So you will not take over the reserves of selling company. But you have an investment allowance reserve which should be compulsorily taken over because it is a statutory reserve. So investment allowance reserve is 50 plus 30. Investment allowance reserve 80. To take over, I'll write an additional entry in the case of purchase method, that is amalgamation adjustment account debit to your statutory reserve. So if you have written statutory reserve under reserves and surplus, we have to write amalgamation adjustment under asset side, non-current assets. Non-current liabilities, 15% debentures. Check the discharge. 15% debentures are 43 plus 24, 67. Public deposits. Again a non-current liability. Total of public deposits, 25. Remaining two are current liabilities. Creditors and bills payable. Come on. Creditors. 145 plus 75. 220. Bills payable. 20. Next. Assets. Non-current assets, under non-current, first tangible assets, tangible fixed assets, I have two things, land and building and plant and machinery. Land and building, 460 plus 275 is 735. Plant and machinery, 325 plus 210 is 535. Then I have other non-current assets. One such other non-current asset is investments. Check, 75 plus 50, 125. Other one is amalgamation adjustment, never forget this. if it is a purchase method and if I have taken over your investment allowance reserve, compulsorily we get amalgamation adjustment account for the same amount, 80. Balance 4 are current assets. Write the amount stock. Let's place this first. Stock, debtors, bills receivable, cash in bank. That should give us the total. Come on. Stock, 325 plus 269. This should be 594. Debtors, 305 plus 270, 575. Bills receivable, 25. Cash in bank, the total is 636 minus what you are paying in cash to debenture holders. This total is 0.33 plus 27. The total amount that you have paid is 0.6. That you are paying in cash. So your cash should reduce by 0.6. So what we get here is only 635.4. Actually it should have been 636. But 0.6 is paid in cash to debenture holders. So it becomes 635.4. And that will bring us to the total of I think this is 0.4.4. Check if the balance sheet total is correct. Correct, because in the asset side we did not do any adjustments. So the total of this is 3225 plus an additional asset amalgamation adjustment 80. So 3225 plus 80 is 3305 minus cash of 0.6, 3304.4. So let's check on the liability side, because I just did it from the assets. Get the liability side total, it should be the same. Let's go for the third one, question number 3. It's only computation of PC. A massive company was incorporated on 1st July 2012 for the purpose of acquiring three companies, north, west, south. All three companies acquired by one purchasing company whose name is Massive Limited. They have left out on North Limited, I don't know why. The summarized balance sheet is given to you on 30th June 2012. Yeah, they left East. On North Limited, South Limited and West Limited, the values are given to you. tangible assets, goodwill, other assets. That's it, only three values. Liabilities, have equity share capital, P&L, one reserve, then 10% debentures and creditors. That's it. And below the balance sheet, he has given you two other values. Average annual profits before debenture interest is 90,000, 120,000 and 50,000. Next, professional valuation of tangible assets in, on 30th June 2012, 6,20,000, 4,80,000 and 3,60,000. So he has changed the values of tangible assets. Read the point number one. Directors in their negotiation agreed that the recorded value of goodwill in South Limited is valueless, so that can be taken as zero. Other assets of North Limited, book value is 2 lakhs, but he is saying it is only worth 30,000. So instead of taking 2 lakhs, we will start valuing it at 30,000 now. Valuation as on 30th June in respect of tangible fixed assets should be accepted. So the last line in the table, that should be taken as the value of tangible assets. The adjustment should be made in the individual company before making completing the acquisition, and the acquisition agreement provides for issue of 12% unsecured debentures to the value of the net assets of the companies north, south, west. So that means one part of PC is in form of 12% unsecured debentures, and your PC in unsecured debentures should be equal to the value of net assets. So calculate net assets. That net assets should be PC in 12% debentures. Continuing that, and that means extra over and above those debentures plus for issue of 10 rupees nominal value ordinary shares for capitalized average profits of each acquired company in excess of net assets contributed, taking a capitalization rate of 10%. Simple understanding, guys. He's talking about 10 rupee ordinary share being issued by Massive Limited for what? For capitalized average profits in excess of net assets. That means, how do you get capitalized average profits? Here he has given average annual profits above, right after the balance sheet. So there's a cap annual average annual profits before debenture interest given to you. You deduct debenture interest, you get average annual profits. Now, if I have to get capitalized average profits, then what do you do? Divided by capitalization rate. So your average profits divided by capitalization rate, which is already given to you as 10% in the last line. Then you will get what is capitalized average profits. Am I giving equity shares for the extent of capitalized average profits? No. Very clearly he said, for capitalized average profits of each acquired company in excess of net assets. That means you need to deduct net asset value from your capitalized average profits, and the balance will be your PC in equity shares. So two parts of PC. First one is 12% debenture. Second one is equity shares. To calculate 12% debentures, we need to do net assets. To calculate your equity shares, we need to go for capitalized average profits. Go on. It's only asking PC, that's it, and nothing else. PC in 12% debentures. PC in 12% debentures is equal to their net assets. Maintain three columns, north, west, south. Go on. To calculate net assets, I need to start with my assets first. Assets first. Tangible fixed assets. Value of tangible fixed assets. Take the professional valuation, he said. Professional valuation, you can pick up from that 6,20,000, 4,80,000, and 3,60,000. Very good. Next. Second asset I see in the balance sheet is goodwill, but the first point itself given below, regarded the recorded value of goodwill in South Limited is valueless. I will not consider that. The second one which I have to consider is your other assets. In your other assets, North Limited other assets are only valued at 30,000. Remaining values are not given, so you can take the book values itself. 2,80,000 and 85,000. That's it. That is your assets. My total assets are 6,50,000, 7,60,000 and 4,45,000. Deduct your outside liabilities from this. I have two outside liabilities. The first one is your creditors. And the second one is debentures. Creditors, 80,000, 1,30,000. 35,000. Debentures 70,000. Nil 40,000. Liabilities total is 1,50,000, 1,30,000, 75,000. Sufficient enough to get your PC. In 12% debentures. PC in 12% debentures is 5 lakhs. This is nothing but your net assets. 5 lakhs. This should be 6,30,000. This should be 3,70,000. This is your PC in 12% debentures. My next one is PC in equity shares. Maintain the columns as it is. It is capitalized average profit. So I'll start with the profits given. Average annual profit before interest. I did not deduct the interest yet. Without deducting the interest, he has given you the average profits. Average profits given to me is 90,000, 1,20,000 and 50. 90, 120, 50 less debenture interest it's a 10% debenture, guys. 10% debentures on debenture interest is 10% of 70,000, 7,000. Nil, 4,000. So from here we can identify average profits. Average annual profit is 83, 120, 46. Then what is capitalized average profits? If I use a capitalization rate of 10%, that means I have to divide this average profits by 10%. divide by 10% or multiply by 10, both are same, because divide by 10% is divided by 10 into 100. So just add 10. 8 lakh 30, 12 lakhs, 4 lakh 60. Am I giving equity shares for this value? No. He clearly said capitalized average profits in excess of net assets. That means how much is your capitalized profits more than the value of the net assets. I know both. I know capitalized average profits. I know net assets. So deduct the value of net assets from this. Minus net assets. Deduct. 5 lakhs. 630. 370. That's it. PC in equity shares. 3 lakh 30. 5 lakh 70. 90,000. 2 PCs. Can I get the total PC? Debentures plus equity shares, total PC. 8 lakh 30, 12 lakhs and 4 lakh 60, total PCs. I just added both. PC in equity shares plus PC in debentures.